The amazing thing, as we saw on that video, short clip there, Jeremiah came and preached to Judah for 40 years. And during the whole of that 40 years, he preached destruction. The first part of his commission, he preached that he was going to pluck up, break down, destroy, and to overthrow this nation that neglected him, this nation that promised to follow him. This is what he was going to do. We've been going as a church for some years now, and it hasn't been easy. There have been many tough times that we've come across, but imagine Jeremiah, here he is. He starts off as a teenager and he starts preaching these words of destruction to Judah. That must have been very fearful to start with, but nobody listened. Nobody wanted to know. We saw him, last time we looked at this, we saw that he was imprisoned. He was persecuted. He was put in a cistern, left to die. But yet, as it said on the video that we've just watched, he persisted. He carried right the way through 40 years, and he didn't see the result of what he had been preaching. And here we are. We're in here in Mulscombe, as we've been for all these years. And God hasn't given up on us. There's times when we've almost given up on God. But God has provided something for us all the way along the line to keep us going. That's his faithfulness. And this is his faithfulness to Judah and Israel. Initially, Jeremiah came and reminded Judah of their history and their failure in keeping God's covenant. But now, in the final part, we're looking more at the declaration of hope that he also brought. This is, he was now going to build and to plant. This begins very simply with these verses. In Jeremiah 32, 6 to 15, Jeremiah is told, amidst all the destruction that's going on, and part exile that's going on at this time, he is told to go and purchase a field. Now, why would anybody go and purchase a field in the midst of this destruction when people are being taken out of Jerusalem? God was showing the people that there was going to be hope for the future, and this would be the start of it. So in practical terms, he got Jeremiah to go and buy a field and said, you will be coming back eventually. In Jeremiah 25, 11 to 13, God says, this whole land will be a desolation and a horror, and these nations will serve the kings of Babylon for 70 years. Then it will be, when 70 years are completed, I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation for their iniquity. So for 70 years, here we come, we're coming now to a period of time when the Israelites can look forward to returning to Jerusalem. In Jeremiah 29:10, the Lord says, when 70 years have been completed for Babylon, I will visit you and fulfill my good word to you to bring you back to this place. God had made a promise. You will return from exile. You're going to exile for a period of 70 years and then you will come back to me. We see the fulfillment of this beginning in Daniel. Daniel 9, 2 and 3. In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, observed in the books the number of the years which was revealed as the word of the Lord to Jeremiah, the prophet, for the completion of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. So I gave my attention to the Lord God to seek him by prayer and supplication with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. So Daniel began to prepare himself for the return. And then we see in Nehemiah and Ezra the beginning. They were returning to Jerusalem. In 2 Chronicles 36, 20 and 21, we see God moving upon Cyrus to release the Jews to Jerusalem. Now Cyrus had now become the new king. He was ruling over all the lands, and so he then planned to send the Jews back. And that was part of it. And when we look at these things, and I don't know when the Jews looked at those words and read the words of Jeremiah that to build and to plant, that there's going to be something new coming along. He had promised that they would be returning to Jerusalem. I wonder just what they did think at that time, because there they were under pressure. They were being thrown out of their land. They were losing that. The temple had been destroyed. That they had relied on for so many years had been destroyed. But now, there was something far deeper and wider than anyone, especially the Jews, could expect or foresee. Because we've just read on that passage, seen on the film there. Jeremiah 31:31. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. A new covenant. Well, what is a covenant? It's rather a bit of an old-fashioned term. They used agreement on that that snip there on the video. This word covenant is not just a biblical thing. It was used widely in the cultures of the time. It was used between one nation and another, known as a treaty. It was used amongst individuals, a pledge of friendship, or as a business contract, or as a marriage contract, something like that. And it was also used by the rulers as they ruled their subjects. It was a sort of a constitution. You do this, and I'll do this. Much like politicians we've got today. They'll say, you do this, and we'll do that. Whether they keep to it or not, it's different, but it's not a sealed covenant that was this sort of thing, but it was a real thing by which parties were drawn together to keep. And it's not surprising, then, that God also made use of this covenant in describing his covenant and in bringing it to the people of the Jews. They would have known what a covenant was, and so they would have entered into that sort of thing. And a biblical covenant, someone's written it like this. A biblical covenant is a clear statement of God's purposes and intentions expressed in terms that bind God by a solemn oath to perform what he has promised, and also, in Israel's covenant, binds them in a similar manner through their oath. So an ancient covenant represented the nation's claim on God's mercy and favour. But for that, Israel must keep the Torah. Now, it was interesting what you're studying with Julian, because he's gone through the various of the covenants. That Israel was a covenant nation. That means that they have been chosen by God. As we see in Deuteronomy 7:6, God says to them, "For you are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be your people for his own possession. And all the peoples who are on the face of the earth." He had chosen Israel. And he had chosen Israel because he had made a promise earlier to Abraham that out of his loins would come a nation of people that would serve him, that would be his people. But they would be in captive for 400 years, and after that they would come together as a people. And this was what Moses, the covenant of Moses, he brought them out of Egypt, and they met with God at Sinai. And we can read all about that in Exodus 19:24. And this was about 1450 BC. The people of Israel gathered at the foot of the mountain, and God appeared in a cloud on the top of the mountain. They saw flames, they heard noises. They must have been scared stiff seeing this thing at the top of the mountain. And then God spoke to them. They actually heard the words of God speaking to them. And they were terrified. So terrified that they decided, we don't want to hear this anymore. Let Moses stand on our behalf. Already, they hadn't received what God so much hoped that they would receive. And there, at that mount, they promised that they would obey God. They said, if you read through 19 and 20 and 24, they said, all that the Lord has promised, we will do. They put their name to the covenant. They saw God and they said, yes, we will obey. But it wasn't very long before they didn't. Shortly after that, only a matter of days, while Moses was still up on the mountain, they prepared an idol. The interesting thing is, actually, if you look through that passage, passages about the golden calf, that they prepared this idol not to worship the idol as a separate God, but to worship God through the idol. And God said, that's not what I want. You know, so many people we can see today will worship God through an idol, but God doesn't want that. He wants us to worship God directly through Jesus Christ. We have a direct access to Him. Israel consistently disobeyed, and therefore they experienced the promised disciplines, because what God said is, we can read in Deuteronomy, God said, if you disobey, this is what's going to happen to you. You will go and be exiled amongst the nations. I won't take all this disobedience. You have declared you're going to follow me, so follow me. But they didn't. So we see the breakup of the northern kingdom, Israel, and they were deported in 722 BC, and the southern kingdom, Judah, was deported in 586 BC, and that's what Jeremiah is all about, warning that they are going to be deported. He gave them an opportunity, even as wicked as they were, he said, look, repent now, and you can still remain in the land, but they didn't. And what questions will come about that? The big question is, had Israel's sin at last caused God to withdraw the promises made to Abraham and David? When we come to the Lord, when we come knowing, we come giving our lives to the Lord and say, yes, Lord, we repent of our sin, we will follow you. But very often we fail. Sometimes our failure to us is so bad, we think we've had it. There's no way back. God's wiped me clean. I can't. Look, just look at me. Look what I've done. How can he possibly accept me back? Look what Israel had done. They'd worshipped idols. They'd sacrificed their own children. Had he given them up? Was the promise to Abraham and David worthless? Jeremiah says in 29:11-14, I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for a calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and will gather you from all the nations and from all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from where I have sent you into exile. No, he hadn't completely rejected the Jews, just as he hasn't completely rejected us when we sin. We have a way back. He invites them to come and return, pray, open up. Jeremiah 23:3-6. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them and bring them back to their pasture, and they will be fruitful and multiply. I will also raise up shepherds over them, and they will tend them, and they will not be afraid any longer, nor be terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up a righteous, for David, a righteous judge, and he will reign as king and act wisely and do justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will dwell securely. And this is his name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness. Here we begin to see the coming of Jesus. He doesn't know it, Jeremiah, at this time. He doesn't know it. But here he is saying, look, I will raise up for David a righteous branch. His name will be the Lord, our righteousness. And then he goes on in Jeremiah 31:27-28. Behold, days are coming. Another phrase, it's quite a popular phrase. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will sow the house of Israel and the house of Judah with the seed of man and with the seed of beast. As I have watched over them to pluck up, to break down, to overthrow, to destroy, and to bring disaster, so I will watch over them to build and to plant, declares the Lord. So that commission that he had given to Jeremiah is repeated again there. I have watched over them to pluck up, to break down, to overthrow, to destroy, and to bring disaster. So, as I have just done that, he says, I will also watch over them to build and to plant. And now comes the time for building and planting. And then we come to the verses that we've just looked at here in Jeremiah 31:31. These are amazing verses. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant which I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke, although I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their heart I will write it. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. They will not teach again each man his neighbor and each man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. The huge obstacle between man and God is sin. There is no way around it, although we in the world might think there are plenty of ways around it. I mean, I might say I don't believe in God, so then I'm let off. Or I don't believe what you said there, but I'm a good man, I'm helping everybody. And so therefore that will weigh against anything that I've done wrong. That's not it. There's a huge gulf between that. The gulf is sin, and the gulf of sin is not trusting and acknowledging God. It's as simple as that. Jesus said, repent and believe. Repent and believe. That's all it is. That's all we have to overcome that. But unfortunately, we find it difficult to get that far. And all this points back to the Abrahamic covenant of faith. Now, when Abraham was chosen, he was an idolater. He didn't believe in God, but God chose him. We don't know why, but he chose him. And he chose him, and it says, Abraham believed in God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. Abraham had faith. That's all he had. He still carried on doing some of the things that were wrong, but he had faith in God. He decided that, yes, because of what God has done, I shall follow him. God has made himself real to him. And this is it, all it is about. And David referred to Hebrews, and this, if we read through Hebrews, the passages that he says, 7 to 9, I think he said, but particularly Hebrews 8. The writer of the Hebrews goes, and this is Hebrews 8, 6 to 13, but now he has obtained a more excellent ministry, by as much as he is also the mediator of a better covenant, which has been enacted on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion for a second. For finding fault with them, he says, and then he repeats what Jeremiah wrote, Behold, days are coming, says the Lord. So we see that there was a covenant that God had set with his people. They broke it, and God knew that now it's not necessary anymore for each man to teach his neighbor about God or to know God, because That new covenant was constituted. It was promised 600 years before Christ, but it was not made and confirmed until the cross. And that's why we have the breaking of bread, to acknowledge and proclaim, as the scripture says, that Christ died on a cross. We proclaim his death until he comes, because his death is the one sacrifice that opens up to everybody. Everybody, without exception, no matter how wicked, no matter how good you might think you are, that's the one thing that opens up Christ to us. And that speaks of the suffering servant of Isaiah 53. If you read Isaiah 53, it's amazing just how accurate this was, written 600 or 700 years before Christ. And yet it explains just who Christ is, just what will happen. And still the Jews cannot see that. And so do many Christians, or so-called Christians, still fail see the promise that was given about Christ. So the new covenant is no longer do this and live, but receiving the I will of God, who promises that he himself will transform us from within. Paul argues in Romans 4 and in Galatians 3 that the essence of the covenant is a promise. And our response is what? It's believing in Christ. If you remember in Acts 2, 37 to 40, the disciples preached and told what had happened about Jesus, and they said to him, said to the disciples, now, when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? What shall we do? That's the question for us today, always. What shall we do? What did he say? Repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. So from Jeremiah, reading through that, we come and pick up all of the rest of the faith of Abraham and the promise of Christ. It is faith alone that saves us. Faith in Jesus. Faith is the seal of God's new covenant. Faith. Now, it's not a sort of thing where we say, oh yeah, well we've got to build up faith, we've got to get faith. Oh yes, I've got faith for this brother. It's not that. It's a reality that comes upon us, a knowledge that God is God. So we come to this new covenant. Is now made and confirmed. It's ours for the possession. It's ours for the taking because of the cross. The promise of forgiveness is assured through the cross. You come to the cross, you'll get it. You'll get forgiveness. But yet, we will not see it realized until the end of time. When Jesus returns, then we can see it. The full meaning of all that it is. But yet today, we can still experience that through the promised Holy Spirit that comes to live within us. God's actually God living within us, and so we can experience the reality of the heavenly realm if we want to. If we really want to follow God, if we're really prepared to give ourselves to God. And I say that to myself as well as everybody else. Here we come. Yes, okay, we very often think, especially as we go on and get older in the Christian faith, yeah, we know all of that, do we? It's deep within. There needs to be changes all the time. Every day God is changing us. And if we're not experiencing the change every day, then there's something wrong between you and God. If God is not speaking and doing something within your life which is changing you, there's something wrong. We should be seeking God all of the time, that we might know his will and his way. So that we don't just act, but it's acting out of his will by bringing him into our lives, everything that we do. Yes, we go about our daily work, we go about everything, but introduce him into that, and then we know that we'll be walking forward with him. So Jeremiah brought a great message, a message of destruction, and finished with a message of hope, which he didn't ever understand, never came to know, but we do, because since the cross it has been made clear to us.